Okay, so folks, welcome back to Management 760. As you can see, I have a pretty good sunlight as a backdrop here. It's a beautiful afternoon, late afternoon in Northwest Louisiana, and I hope the weather finds you well wherever you're living. Today is our last week of lecture. It's week 7 or module 7, and we're going to discuss, first of all, in the A portion of the week, chapter 8 from the textbook, and then we'll have our, as usual, our 7B, which will be our last lecture for the course. The chapter is titled Executing Strategy Through Organizational Design, and we want to cover two major things in this chapter. One is the reality of organizational structure, and secondly, the notion and reality of corporate control or control systems. Those two things academics refer to as organizational design. It's interesting that the authors chose just these two topics to talk about executing strategy. There's actually a lot more involved. We're not going to have time to go through it in our course, but I'll pick up a little bit more in the 7B lecture, which is the more advanced lecture. Okay, the learning objectives, starting on slide 4, we want to talk about some basic notions of organizational structure, division of labor, unity of command, spans of control, that kinds of thing. We want to talk about vertical and horizontal linkages. You can kind of read these learning objectives as we go through to slide 5. And then we're going to finish out the chapter with just a short discussion of the different legal forms of business. Okay, when you think of organizational structure, you think of an organizational chart, right? And immediately you start yawning. You look at how the boxes are arranged and who is pointing to who, and you might think that this is a very mundane and boring part of organizations and strategy. I'd like to offer to you this. It's not. It's one of the most exciting aspects for students of organization and strategy. And in my consulting years, my 25 years in consulting, I was involved with 4 or 5 major new restructuring projects. The reason why organizational structure is not boring at all is you may see that sort of static picture of who's reporting to who, but really, when we dig deep inside of an organization, we're going to see that that's where the power resides. Those are the power bases. And obviously, the higher up that organizational chart you go, the more power is resonant in those senior top executives, you know, who you are role-playing right now for your Legos case, for example. So on slide, let's see, I've written over it here. It'd be on slide 6 with the cartoon characters. We want to talk about, first of all, division of labor, and that's simply splitting work into smaller tasks. For us in strategy, it's really how are we going to group like entities so that they can become experts, and here's the key, where they can interface with customers. By the end of the lecture, and then when we get to 7B lecture, we'll see sometimes firms need to change the way they're structured so that they can meet the customer interfaces more clearly. So division of labor is just how we're going to group like people, sales, marketing, R&D. So that's called division of labor. Those lines in that organizational chart typically depict formal relationships. In other words, I, Bill Bigler, report to Joe Smith, and that is a formal reporting relationship. Those of you who are working now have a boss, and you report to that boss. As the chart shows to the right, there's also informal linkages that the organizational chart does not show. So in any organization, for instance, I might not like my boss, and so, or I may not be able to communicate with my boss, and therefore I might have a series of informal relationships with my peers to try to understand my boss, understand the direction he or she wants the company or the business unit or the department to go. And then in the middle there, you can see is just a depiction of the organizational chart, and that's where we're trying to portray those formal linkages. If you go to the next slide, which it's titled Building Blocks of Organizational Structure, you can see the notion of horizontal linkages, vertical linkages. There's one concept they do not discuss in the chapter that is crucial, and that is the notion or the principle of span of control. Span of control is, as we're thinking about how we're going to form the organizational structure, is how many people should report directly to one person. At the turn of the century into the 2000s, we used to think that optimal span of control was only 5 people. In other words, a CEO would have 5 direct reports. Each of the direct reports would have 5 people on down the line. And if we think about that, get out a piece of paper. And let's say we have an organizational chart of 200 people, or an organization of 200 people, and set the span of control at 5, and just draw this out. So we got a CEO, that person, has 5 direct reports, each of them have 5 direct reports, each of them have 5 direct reports. What happens is we end up with what's called a very tall organizational structure. So by the time we have all 200 people slotted in that organizational structure, it tends to be a very tall span of control situation. Let's say in many consulting firms we have a span of control of 100 people. Try that. So we've got a CEO. The CEO has 100 people directly reporting to that CEO. Well, by the time we get to 200 people, we've barely gotten into the second level of an organization, and that's called a very wide organizational structure. So small spans of control produce very tall structures. Large spans of control produce very flat or wide organizational structures. And it's a very interesting principle. With today's modern technology, with technology enablement in GoToMeeting, GoToWebinar, this has allowed the span of control to become much larger in organizations than in times past. Down at the bottom of that slide is a notion of unity of command. And that says a person should have one and only one boss that they report to. We'll see here in a minute that the matrix organizational form of structure violates the unity of command principle on purpose. So let's talk about the various forms of organizational structure. In the order that the chapter discusses them, this maps on to an organization as it grows. So usually when an organization is started, it'll have what is simply called a simple structure. And that is the CEO and president and basically workers in a company. I have a small company right now. If you go to www.strategybest.com, that's all one word, strategybest.com, you'll see I have a website that offers knowledge to primarily senior strategy professionals in the world. And I use right now a simple structure. It's me and basically my web designer and some other resources that I bring in from time to time. Well, advantages, we can be very flexible. We can wake up one morning and decide to take on different roles. I'll ask my web designer from time to time, what does he think we should do? So, sometimes he takes on the role of CEO. The disadvantages is a lack of clear guidance from the top of the organization can create confusion. That is true. I would add here that there's a lack of clear accountabilities. Like I said, we wake up one morning and we may play different roles. By the way, many people in today's workforce, especially the millennial generation, enjoy that flexibility. They enjoy really a lack of clear-cut roles from day to day and almost being mavericks. Well, as the organization grows and gets more successful, the next organizational form will be the classic functional organizational structure. And that's where people are divided into departments, like marketing, production, human resources, information technology, and customer service. Here we see a real grouping of people who are trained very similarly and have a very similar mindset and view of the business. Marketing tends to see the business one way, sales another, R&D a different way. Advantages, each person gets to learn a great deal about that particular function and they become an expert in that function. Disadvantages, I'm just skipping through here. You can read these in the slide yourself. Executing changes can be very slow in a functional structure. The chapter mentions this classic function now of a functional silo. We get to be so good at marketing, so good at sales, so good at R&D, that particular lens tends to be the organization. And as such, if at times we need to unite these various functional groups to get to everybody, you know, have everybody pushing in the same direction or pulling in the same direction, rowing by the same pattern, many times this can be very difficult to do. And we can see the next chart is an example of a functional structure. If I decide to grow my business and monetize the business, right now everything on it is free, but if I decide one day that I want to try to be a profit making, the next move in organizing my organization would be the functional structure. Again, that functional structure, as it grows and grows, it finds new markets of opportunity, it will end up as a multi-divisional structure of some kind. And that is where employees are divided into different departments based on product or geography. I'm going to say a little bit more about that in week 7B lecture. It shouldn't be departments, it should be business units. When we jump from a multi-divisional form of structure, either by product, by geography, by customer. Again, I'll spell that out in 7B. What we're really doing is creating separate businesses that have their own profit and loss statement. So they're not departments per se that manage only to a cost budget that we find in the functional structure, but they're business units that have their own profit and loss accountability. Well, the advantages of that is allows the firm to act quickly because each business unit is focused only on their one business. And if we're organized by the customer form of division, it allows us to serve customer needs a lot better. Disadvantages, empowering divisions to quickly act can backfire if what they're doing does not fit the overall strategy. I think I've used the example before of Mallinckrodt, the medical imaging company in St. Louis. They had a huge mess there of the multi-divisions. They would come together for a strategic planning exercise at the beginning of the year. Everybody would agree on what the divisions would be doing. And then they'd go back to their shops and they would do what they wanted to do anyway. And they tend to be more costly than a functional structure because why? They tend to duplicate each of those functions. So let's say we're organized by product. Product one will have its own sales, marketing, human resources. Product two division will also have its own marketing sales. So we tend to get some duplication of functions, which does tend to make that form of structure more costly. Well, what is the flip side of that? What do we hope to gain? We hope to gain more revenue by focusing on the business, more revenue than we are adding costs. And the next slide shows an example of General Electric as a classic form of multi-divisional structure. And if you look down at the bottom, you can, and we've talked about GE before in our other lectures, that tends to be a very unrelated form of diversification, now combining some of our terminology to produce their form of multi-divisional structure. Matrix structures are very interesting because here is where we break the unity of command. And the best way to see it is to jump to slide 18 right after 17. We'll come back to that. And there you can see an array that has three direct reports to the CEO in this hypothetical organizational chart. The business analyst manager, the development manager, and the quality assurance manager. And then those would form the columns. And then the rows are a series of product managers. Well, let's say this is a software technology company that makes different applications for smartphones. Product manager one could be, let's say, we do scheduling apps. Let's say someone downloads our application for them to schedule their time. Okay, let's say a physical fitness trainer wants a way that he or she can schedule appointments better. Product management two could be an entertainment application. Let's say we want to help people find places to go, venues to go as they travel different cities. Product manager three might be a journalism application. Let's say we have an application that would help journalists with more real-time reporting. Well, if you notice the business analyst in the first row, that person has two bosses. That person reports to product one manager, but it also reports to the overall business analyst manager. Matrix forms of organizational structure are fairly rare. People end up organizing that way if they find they need to move very quickly. So let's go back to the advantages and disadvantages. The matrix structure, boy, they do allow huge amounts of flexibility. They allow cutting across functional lines, can create a tremendous spirit of teamwork. But again, the disadvantages definitely violates the unity of command principle. And there can be potential conflicts that can arise. Let's say that product manager one wants the business analyst for more time than what the business analyst manager wants for that time. So we can have conflicts in that form of structure. So what we'll see in lecture 7B is that, again, those are the forms of structure that an organization typically moves to as it grows and becomes more successful. In 7B, what we're going to call a network structure, they don't talk about it in the chapter. That's where we're actually going to try to erase the formal boundaries in an organization. And Jack Welch was the one that first tried to do this. Hewlett-Packard has tried to do this. And that is the ultimate in becoming flexible and responsive. But we'll wait till 7B to talk about the problems of a boundaryless organization. So an organizational structure is not a one-time activity. We need to revisit, though, the organizational chart. Most firms revisit it about every 5 years, and we might need to adjust it if it becomes too complex. It needs to be simplified. Matrix structures and network structures are very complex. Hewlett-Packard, for many years, would change its organizational form every 5 years just to shake things up. Didn't want people getting comfortable in normal reporting roles, and so it felt it could make for a very fluid organization if it did that, but they found that that was going overboard. So about every 5 to 7 years, organizations will tinker with their organizational form to try to make it in alignment with the strategy framework. And you're going to have to decide in Skill Builder Application 2 what form of structure LEGO should be using. Okay, so organizational control is just simply, how are we going to monitor and make sure the organization is performing as we said it would? So we're providing control over the organization's activities. There's three basic forms: output, behavioral, and clan control. And as the last bullet point says on slide 21, the organizations tend to emphasize different kinds of control over the other, but in essence try to use all three. So output control is simply, we're going to control the goals. You remember our conversation early on in the session around SMART goals. So if we said that sales is going to grow 5% this year, or operating profit margin is going to grow by 2% this year, organizational control comes in and says, did we actually do that? So you remember our notion of single loop learning. If the measures are not what we said they were going to be, we have a performance gap. And then we can decide, okay, what needs to change to for us to hit that target measure? Or was the measure too high to begin with? Behavioral control tries to focus on the behaviors that will lead to the outputs. And typically what firms do there is they will, we won't have time this course to talk about compensation. Sorry for the ambulance going by. But behavioral control tries to control those actions that ultimately lead to those results. And we look at particular behaviors. But where I lost my train of thought there when I heard the siren is, typically what will happen is that they will lower base pay and make incentive compensation be much higher total compensation possibility if certain behaviors lead to certain results. So for instance, Jeff Immelt at General Electric decided that GE had to get a lot more innovative. So he introduced a process called Imagination Breakthroughs, and that's where he incented all of his business leaders to take on behaviors. They were all trained, by the way, in becoming more innovative, but there he wanted to measure innovation traits and innovation behaviors directly. So they also had output control. The business was expected to perform, but he said, I have to change behaviors before I can change or be expecting that the output will change. Clan control is simply very informal control that comes out of the culture in an organization where we basically, and we'll see in a couple slides, we'll mention this notion of a very strong culture where the expectations, values, and norms and shared traditions put self-control on people. Now, I don't want to sound Pollyannish. This is difficult to do in most firms, but firms like Google, Apple, I've brought them up a lot. Firm you may not heard of IDEO, it's four letters, IDEO, all caps. Google them sometime, look their website. They're the leading firm in helping people, helping organizations create new products. They all have very strong cultures where people can recognize each other as violating the culture or not in terms of control. So what are the various types of control systems? Chapter's going to give us just a few. First of all is management by objectives. We studied that a little bit in when we took a look at SMART goals. The balanced scorecard is the current form of management by objectives, and this is just simply spelling out a series of SMART goals and holding people accountable to those SMART goals. Sensitivity training is really out of date, and this is a way in which we try to help people understand each other better as opposed to getting in fights, not literally fights, although I guess this has happened from time to time, but so that we can become more sensitive to each other's views and help each other along the path of controlling performance in an organization. Quality circles, again, we learned that from the Japanese. The current form of quality, the quality movement, is called Lean Six Sigma. And there is, we want to try to, as the bullet points show, face trade-offs among quality, cost, flexibility, and speed. We get together in teams of people, learning the principles of Lean Six Sigma, trying to control the organization by controlling our cost, our flexibility, our speed, and our quality. Strong cultures, okay, simply, they are cultures that have universally respected and agreed to values and beliefs. For many companies, the statement of culture is really window dressing. People will publish, here are our values, but we don't see a one-to-one match in the behaviors in an organization. Firms that have strong cultures, like Google, Apple, IDEO, I would say General Electric, know the values, know what the organization aspires to do. One of the most brilliant CEOs I had the occasion to work for when I was in consulting was a guy by the name of Mike Waterman. He was a serial entrepreneur and built several organizations. Well, in fact, you remember in the opening example, Flower Country USA was one. Here was a statement that we had for Flower Country. We are a team of people who say what we mean what we say, and deliver what we promise. So we're a team of people who say what we mean what we say, and deliver what we promise. And that wasn't idle verbiage. The values and beliefs behind those statements and the practice day by day of everyone practicing those behaviors clearly showed when someone was out of bounds of that very strong culture. Okay, so as we end up chapter 8 in lecture 7A, different legal forms of business are necessary sometimes to get it right to execute the strategy. A sole proprietorship is what I have in my business, www.strategybest.com. It's owned by one person, and me and the company are interchangeable. And the note you'll see, or the trend you'll see through these different forms, is who gets sued if there is a problem in the organization. Well, as a sole proprietor, with me being the business, I personally can get sued if someone does not like my work. A partnership, those of you who are accountants know, you know, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Ernst & Young, Deloitte, KPMG are organized as partners, and jointly those partners own the firm. So, again, as it says, it's common among dental practices and law offices, accounting firms, and also consulting firms, the larger consulting firms. Two of my assignments was in the management consulting divisions of Ernst & Young and PricewaterhouseCoopers. A corporation, Legos is a corporation, GE is a corporation. That form, that legal form of ownership, splits splits out, if you will, the managers from the corporation. In the corporation, shareholders don't receive profits or absorb losses directly, but it's reflected in if the price of our stock that we own increases and we get dividends. But the key there is the ownership and management are split. So Jeff Immelt and his top management team at General Electric cannot get personally sued. The corporation gets sued. I think earlier in one of our discussions, Walmart fends off, on average, about 3,000 lawsuits a year. And those are directed at the corporation, not the CEO. A limited liability corporation is a hybrid between a corporation and a partnership. Like a corporation, the owners are not accountable for the firm's debts. And it's just a way that that form of business decides on how it's going to treat taxes. And lastly, an S corporation is a specialized form of a corporation. It's limited by no more than 100 shareholders. And the neat thing about it is that the income is only taxed once. One of the things that the problem of a corporation is dividends are taxed twice. So those of you who are accountants know that the corporation pays taxes, and then I, as Bill Bigler, when I get dividends, that's taxable to me as well. So, okay, that's it. That's quick and dirty on Chapter 7. And so we will stay tuned for Lecture 7B, where we'll take up the notion of strategy execution in a little bit advanced form. Thanks a lot.